Good afternoon. Welcome to Halftime Report. It's 12 noon. We're halfway through the trading session. I am Reema Tendulkar. With me is Nigel D'Souza in the green for the benchmark indices. So continuing with the rally that we saw yesterday. So as we speak, up about 65 points in the Nifty. The Sensex has gained close to about 240 points. But as you can see, we've slipped from the top of the day in the last 1 hour of trade. And that coincides with the weakness that you can see across the Asian market. So if the intraday chart of Hang Seng comes up, you can see that's down about 130 points. But this fall has come through only in the last 30 minutes at the low point over there. The Chinese markets too, down about a quarter of a percent, but weakness only starting as we speak. So that's taking the Nifty down to those 10,800 levels. Lost a bit of ground in the last 30 minutes for our markets.
That's right, Reema. From yesterday's lows, we have gained nearly around 260 points. Also, it's been pretty good going, so some money being taken off the table. In terms of technical levels, well, 10,770. That's where the 200 DMA is at. So just keep an eye out on that mark. 10,770. That's the mark we're looking at in terms of the downside. But let's move on. Let's run you through all the top stories. Then we'll get to all the stocks that are moving around. The markets off the early morning highs and some profit-taking. Reliance, Infosys and TCS lead. The mid-cap index picks up pace.
The next tranche of PSU bank recapitalization bonds worth 28,000 crore rupees may be issued today or tomorrow. Bank of India likely to be the biggest beneficiary. Sources add that Bank of India, OBC and Bank of Maharashtra may exit the PCA framework.
And crude prices see a big surge overnight with Brent crude prices above $54 per barrel. Bond yields and the rupee fall. The IT stocks outperform in trade. Oil marketing companies are under some pressure.
Sources tell Network 18 that the government is likely to dole out SOPs for farmers, most likely to remit the difference between MSP and market price directly to the farmer's account.
And the government tightens the e-commerce FDI policy. Future Retail's Kishore Biyani expects grocery players to see operational difficulties, adds that protecting market share will become a priority.
All right, let's talk about the stocks that are moving and shaking in trade. All our colleagues are here with us. The biggest mover in the broader markets have been a couple of these PSU banking stocks like a Bank of India, a Bank of Maharashtra. These are few banks which could be beneficiaries of the government's recapitalization plan, which was announced earlier today. Lata joins us for more on that. Lata?
Still sourced information, but we are given to understand 28,000 crores of the overall 83,000 crores that is budgeted is going to come today itself. And of that, a lion's share, one-third or even more, is going to Bank of India. 10,086 crores, we understand. I'll just run you through all the numbers. Bank of Maharashtra, 4,498. That's almost 4,500 crore. Oriental Bank of Commerce, 5,500 crores. UCO, 3,000 odd. Central Bank, 1,600 odd. United, another 2,150. And Syndicate, about 1,600 crores. Now, we only concentrate on Bank of India, Bank of Maharashtra and OBC because it appears when you do the math, they look best placed to come out of the prompt corrective action straitjacket, at least two filters they may satisfy. The first of them would be the CET, that is the common equity, the actual shareholder equity. That was for Bank of Maharashtra 5.9, it comes to 7.8, if this entire money goes, which it will, if the source is right. Oriental Bank of Commerce, the CET1 goes from 3.9 to 7.17. Bank of India goes up from 3.29 to 7.53, and so on and so forth. The important point is these guys go above that 6% CET mark, plus that capital can be used to provide for more loans. So the net NPA comes down, and therefore let's come to the net NPA list. You will notice that Bank of India, Bank of Maharashtra and Oriental Bank of Commerce are already like 10 or below 10. So with this kind of capital, it's possible that they will move towards the 6% mark. I think Bank of India will definitely move under 6%. That is the RBI's second filter. You ought to have CET1 above 6 and you ought to have net NPA below 6%. So these three banks have the best chance to move towards that 6% mark. The only other filter that will not be satisfied is that they have to become ROA positive for 2 consecutive years. Or rather, they should not be ROA negative for 2 years. That is, should not be making losses for 2 consecutive years. That will take a while. I mean, they will make their profit only now after the fourth quarter. But chances are the Reserve Bank may agree to remove or dilute that filter if they show enough promise that they will come out of negative ROE. So it's possible that when the bank board of financial supervision of the Reserve Bank meets and decides the new criteria, these banks may well set to come out of the prompt corrective action list. That's Bank of India, Oriental Bank and Bank of Maharashtra. But again, it's not immediate. The rule has to change. It is quite possible that the Reserve Bank also waits for the third quarter numbers, in which case it may be even 3 weeks from now or 4 weeks from now. But it's imminent, so it seems.
Okay, thanks so much for that, Latha. Well, on that note, let's hear out what the management of Syndicate Bank as well as Bank of Maharashtra had to say to us here on CNBC TV 18.
We sent in some calculations regarding capital requirement, but we have not yet heard formally as to what is the exact amount that is coming in. For every 750 to 800 crore, we have an uptick in the capital adequacy of roughly about 50 basis points. Right, I think it will go up by 1%, the CET1. NPA will come, net NPA reductions will come out of recoveries. This will be for other provisions and other meeting the requirements that is required.
4,498 crores, it will be adequate and both it will help the bank to meet both its regulatory capital and also some growth needs. Definitely, it will capital adequacy ratio will go above 11% and all the CET1, all these things also it will be adequately met. In fact, it was on the borderline. Now, it also it will improve. And net NPO, I mean, also percentage also will improve substantially. With this capital, we can come to the vicinity of 6%.
Okay, let's move on and talk about Sun Pharma. It is one of the worst performing stocks in the month of December. It's lost about 15% of its overall value in the last 3 or 4 weeks. But today there seems to be some relief coming in for its subsidiary, Dusa. Ekta joins us for more on that. Ekta?
Well, yes, positive news which is coming for Sun Pharma, where its wholly owned subsidiary, Dusa Pharma, has been granted a preliminary injunction relief by a U.S. court. Now, basically what took place is that the U.S. court basically Dusa Pharma had gone to U.S. court saying that one of the companies, BioFrontera, was basically using confidential information, etc., on one of the products within the dermatological space of Dusa Pharma. So now the U.S. court has basically prohibited this particular company, BioFrontera, from using any of this information, confidential information. Now remember that this is a lawsuit and hence it will probably have some amount of, you know, litigation going forward, but there is a chance that Sun Pharma could probably also benefit from damages going forward with regards to this particular case, and hence maybe that's why the stock is a little more optimistic.
Okay, all right, Ekta, thanks so much for that. Well, Lada still with us. Lada, tell us about the NBFCs.
The Reserve Bank's move has been that you provide adequate capital to the banking system, and the banks and the market will give money to those who deserve it. And therefore, the deserved will come out. Those who don't have a liquidity problem but an asset quality problem ought not to get easy money. And that's why they've maintained the principle of easy liquidity. Yeah. And we had Mr. Rasesh Shah and several others, even Kiki Mistry, tell us that now there is no liquidity problem. The problem is resolved. So this clearly is like Oliver Twist. People will always want more. And there are a bunch of NBFCs, HFCs who have asked for the special line of credit. The Reserve Bank has so far resisted it. But you will have to wait and see as you get near polls. Governments also panic and worry that people will be laid off from construction and things like that. And the construction sector is the biggest employment sector. As it is, there is an accusation of poor job creation. So there may be pressure and you don't know at what all points the Reserve Bank will yield. I mean, this is what they would resist maximum, this special line of credit. But let's see how things go.
Okay, Lata, thank you very much for that. Moving on, the government has tightened the norms for e-commerce companies with foreign direct investment like Amazon and Flipkart. The revised policy makes it tougher for such e-commerce platforms to offer heavy discounts or hold exclusivity on products. We spoke with Kishore Biani of Future Group on what this means for their e-commerce business, and here's what he had to say.
We are seeing in the last 2 years the convergence of physical and digital. It's the product and the brand which you sell to the consumers. Consumers can decide whichever way they want. Physical retailers are creating more and more experiences. Digital retailers are creating more and more promotions and offers. I believe it has come together. If you look at China, it has really come together with acquisition of Whole Foods. Amazon has also made that move. So physical and digital converging together is the theme, I believe, which will go forward. And maybe after 2-3 years, people won't notice what is online or what is offline. Grocery business, wherein there was some people coming into the business, they won't be able to do grocery business in India, personally. That's what is my first impression about this thing, because without inventory, grocery cannot be done. Being in the market and being one of the leading players, we constantly are in discussion with every other player in terms of what can we do together. So I think within the contours of any policy, the discussion continues. So I don't know about a particular transaction or a particular thing which I can comment upon, but I believe the policy was already existing B2B. So there is nothing which has changed for us. Any transaction which we do will be at a group level in terms of what synergies we can build, because we have a supply chain business, we have a FMCG business, we have a fashion business. So we bring in the strength of the entire country's distribution, and we operate in more than 355 cities and towns. So what we bring in our strength has to be complemented with other people's strength, which can create something better.
Okay, all right. On that note, then, let's slip into a short break. Up next, we'll get chatting with the management of KEI Industries. Stay with us.